this work here. I'm very, very happy about that because actually part of this research that I'm going to present, the second part of the talk, it was born here in Pot C. And the first part, well, everything grows out of my the things that I was researching during my PhD. This is the cover of my PhD. I just show it because I'm very, very happy of how it turned out with all the Pink Floyd and many other references within. But the actual first slide of the presentation is this. This is the title. This is the institution where I am now, in Institute for Interdisciplinary Physics and Complex Systems in Mallorca. I know they have openings for postdocs and probably for more senior researchers, if you're interested. It's a very physics-oriented institute, I must warn you. Anyway, as I was saying, much of what I'm going to present grows out of my PhD thesis. And I like to think about my PhD thesis as an exercise of how we in Ricard Solé's group, and I particularly, think about complex systems. And we like to think that there are a very, very simple mathematical principles that might explain phenomenology across many different fields. So one way that we particularly like to approach problems is to first think about those tiny mathematical principles, learn as much as we can about the maths within behind them, and then see how those maths unfold or apply in different fields. In the case of my dissertation, the simple mathematical principles that we were looking at was multi-objective optimization. So what happens when you try to optimize, maximize, minimize several things at the same time, trying to not to introduce biases towards one of the targets that you want to optimize. And looking at the maths of the problem, we find very nice connections with thermodynamics. This is a solution of a multi-objective optimization problem of thermodynamics, which is the Gibbs surface. We find correspondences between this and the solution to general multi-objective optimization problems, where you can read phase transitions and critical points in a series of complex systems in which optimality is applied. And we think that our research was important because there were people doing multi-objective optimization in different systems, and they were applying methods from the literature in multi-objective optimization, and they were coming to wrong conclusions. For example, I like this work here a lot. They use multi-objective optimization to try to optimize different forces involved in protein folding. And then they use methods from multi-objective optimization literature, and they come to the conclusion that certain foldings should be expected. And when you apply what thermodynamics tells us and what our methods tells us, we find that some of those foldings that they come up with, they are actually thermodynamically unstable. So they are wrong. And we think there are also several other research in which people do this multi-objective. They miss phase transition, critical points that I think are worth researching. And as I was saying, once we got a little tiny bit of the maths of this problem, we like to apply it to systems that we could understand. For example, complex networks, try to make networks that are at the same time cheap and also connect well everything in an area. We will read phase transitions, critical points from there. Also, we apply this to a very nice problem of cost optimization in communication, in which speakers try to make their coding of reality as general as possible. Give me that. That is optimal for me, I don't have to worry about anything else, but you as a hearer have to worry a lot about what is that, right? So hearers push in the other direction. This is again a multi-objective optimization problems, and with our methods we can read nice critical phenomena in there, and then we can see what happens with real languages. And finally, what worries us today, we were interested in what we think is a fundamental trade-off that happens in biology. And this trade-off comes out of a tension between replicating quickly and being able to compute the information in your environment to be able to predict what your environment is going to look like in the future. So we were interested in this trade-off. We studied it a little bit differently from the other trade-offs that I saw before, so not with the methods that we developed. And we were interested in this trade-off, because we think that this might underlie part of how complex life came about on Earth and perhaps elsewhere if there is life out there. And I would like to introduce this experiment that pretty much all of you probably know, Spiegelman's experiment, and that yields Spiegelman's monster. So you know, if you put this little chain here of RNA in a tube, and you provide everything that this little chain needs to replicate itself, this will be RNA building blocks and an enzyme that just copies as quickly as possible this little RNA chain. You can start as complex as you want, and when you repeat the experiment many, many times, the experiment consists in just letting the RNA strings get reproduced themselves, and then pick up a little bit of what you find in your tube after a while, dilute it, and start all over again. When you repeat this several times, you consistently converge into what is called Spiegelman's monster. There is one or two variations in which everything that is not fundamental for the replication is thrown away. All the complexity somehow, all the complexity that is not needed disappears, and only remains parts of this RNA chain that are needed for the string to attach to the enzyme that is replicating it. So somehow, when everything is provided, we can see here that there is a certain tendency, there is a natural pressure towards replicate as fast as you can, and to do so, be as simple as you can. And yet, when we look at nature, we find this amazing tree of life with all the diversity, and we find ourselves here using language, talking about complex topics, complexity. We see plants, fungi, whatever. So the question is, why didn't nature stop in those simple replicators that happen to work so efficiently? Stephen Jay Gould proposes that actually nature did. He has a whole book devoted to saying, hey, there is a peak performance in the evolutionary game that is achieved by bacteria. They are the best, they are the fittest. Now, what happens if you are a bacteria and you somehow, because of a fluctuation, become a little bit simpler than a bacteria? You might lose enough complexity that you cannot replicate yourself. So he proposes there is a minimum wall of complexity, which makes sense. On the other half, if a fluctuation makes you a little bit more complex than a bacteria, there is in principle no reason why you might collapse. So fluctuations around this peak performance could be random. They might originate in a simple random shift, but they, because of the existence of this wall at the left of towards lower complexity, any random fluctuation, Wald argues, will look as if complexity was increasing over evolutionary time. Yes?
Can you comment on how you measure complexity for this purpose?
I would love to, but you know, this is one of those debates that we can get stuck here forever. I will tell you later how I measure complexity in my model, and I hope it's satisfying. And Stephen Jay Gould goes to actual examples, and he tries to convince that there is actually no evolutionary pressure towards the emergence of more complex life. And he devotes, as I say, the whole book to argue that all the complexity that we see, it probably stems from a random fluctuation. And this is a naive view of what will result in the distribution of living systems according to this this simple model. It's a naive view because I think that the model can imply other kinds of distributions. But anyway, it's the one that he proposes and the one that he discusses in his book. Well, this is a possibility. We might be here because of a random fluctuation, sheer chance. This doesn't satisfy me much. Following Kaufman, I wish that we're at home in the universe. I wish that our complexity is called for. So we thought that there might be other evolutionary pressures towards the emergence of more complex life. And we thought that those evolutionary pressures might relate to an ability to predict the environment, to extract bits of information from our surroundings, crunch those numbers, and predict what might happen next. And therefore, we set up to build a minimal model that will capture evolutionary forces behind this. One of them has to be quick replication, of course. Another one has to be an ability to compute and to predict what the environment is going to do next. This is what we attempted, and I think what we did in this paper that's already published and is the last chapter of my PhD thesis. And we basically came up with this model that we call the bit guessers, and I will explain later how it works. And it's basically a machine that you drop into an environment. So we model environments as zeros and ones, as a tape, Turing style. And we model our machines pretty much the same, as a tape, also Turing style. So we have machines that we just drop in our environment, and they have a metabolic cost that they have to fulfill for every bit that they try to guess from their environment. And if they guess a bit correctly, they're going to be given a reward. So we can write here, I'm going to write this big because it's going to be with us throughout the talk. Reward of one of these bit guessers is going to be the reward that you get every time that you guess a bit correctly minus the cost that you pay multiplied by the number of bits that you usually guess. So somehow our machines are going to be probabilistic. So when we drop them into environments, there's going to be a chance that they guess correctly each one of the bits. So let me rewrite this as a... and let me remove this, and it's not necessary, actually. So in here, I have introduced this parameter alpha that tells you the relationship between the cost and the reward that you get for every bit that you guess correctly. So if you're in an environment in which alpha equals 0.5, this means that for every bit that you guess correctly, you get twice the cost, you get as a reward twice the cost of trying to guess one bit. This means that if you're in such an environment, just tossing a coin is good enough for you to survive. So you don't need any complex machinery to go on. If alpha becomes bigger, if it becomes close to 1, then for every bit that you guess correctly, you don't get so much reward. This is going to be an important parameter later on. So moving on, as I say, we wanted to model our environments. We model them as a tape of ones and zeros. And there is a very nice thing here. So for our environment, when you go to an environment and you try to extract useful information means that there are correlations in your environment. If it's a completely unstructured environment, there isn't anything that you can use that is going to be useful for your future given your past. So there are many ways in which we can introduce correlations in an arbitrary environment. And what we did was to just take an environment of a finite size m. So the size of the environment captures somehow the complexity. Look at this. When you have a very, very, very large environment, very likely the proportions of ones and zeros that you get is going to be more or less even, close to half and half. The proportions of words 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, or 0, 0, 0, 0 is as your environment becomes bigger and bigger and bigger, is going to approach what you will expect in an infinitely large environment. But the fact that our environments are finite somehow breaks because of a mere finite effects, somehow breaks the symmetry between words of different sizes. Smaller words are the ones that become faster, evenly sampled. Larger words take longer and longer environments to be evenly sampled, which means that in smaller environments, there's going to be more information in smaller words. In larger environments, there's going to be information in larger words. Because of this, the size of the our external environment, of the tape of zeros and ones that we have, is one simple environment that just captures this complexity of the external wall. On the other hand, we have to model our bit guessers. Our bit guessers, as I said before, are machines that we're going to drop into our environments, and they are going to try to guess what's going to happen next. And we can do this in many, many different ways. We can do this with random Boolean networks, spiking neurons, whatever you want. We can do this with epsilon machines, which is actually very, very appealing. Each one of these implementations, it has many details that we wanted to keep out. It has nodes, it has connections between them. All of this will bring in costs that we will need to account for. And we hoped to have something as simple as the environment, so something that we could control with a single number. And therefore, we introduce the bit guessers, these are the equations, but I tell you what they do. So our bit guessers have one simple parameter, which is their size, n. And this is the size of a pattern that they have, that they try to locate in the environment. The first, so whenever we evaluate a bit guesser, we generate an environment, ones and zeros randomly, finite size. And we assume that the guesser has access to the whole environment, but it doesn't know where it's going to be dropped upon evaluation. So the first bit that the guesser guesses that's going to find out is going to be the bit that shows up more often. If there are more ones than zeros in the environment, the first bit is going to be a one. If there are more zeros, the other way around. The second bit that is going to try to guess is going to be the most common bit, provided that the first one that it found was the correct one, the first correct one. And so on and so forth for the third, fourth, up until n. What matters is that bit guessers have a pattern of size n, and they try to locate this pattern in the environment. Whenever we pick up a guesser, we drop it in the environment, they try to guess one bit at a time. If they are correct, they move to the next position in the environment, and they move their guess to the next bit as well. And they go on as long as they guess the bits correctly. Whenever they make a mistake, they reset. Of course, we could make things such as a tree that you could explore. And then again, we will have other costs, such as in the case of whatever kind of machines you want to put here. So we wanted to go for this very, very simple model. Also, why? Because we thought, and we know it's not, we know we cannot prove this is the best. But we thought, if you have an M environment and you have an N capacity to make inferences upon this environment, this somehow is coming close to the limit of how much useful information you can extract from this environment. And we wanted to try to prove that there are evolutionary pressures towards the that will favor more complex such guessers, given the limits that your environments allow. And this is why we went for the bit guessers, and we hope that, just a tiny moment, we hope that by showing that such evolutionary pressures exist in here, we hope that they will be also present in more complex models. Yes?
If I understood correctly, your bit guesser reads this environment in one direction, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So what happens when it gets to the end? Is this a circle?
Yes, it's a circle. Yes. Yes. All right. Yes. You go ahead after me. You were closer.
So it's kind of it's reminds me of like it's like a template matching.
Mm-hmm. Similar to yeah.
I would think like sort of I think chemically, but like the only patterns in the environment are from stochastic fluctuations due to
yes.
samples. Isn't that sort of like? Isn't that? I mean, I would guess that. Life emerged because there's all this free energy and there's all this actually like meaningful information mm-hmm. in the environment, like pointing to where you can find free energy. I don't know. It seems a very restricted information source.
So this is the way in which we decided to implement correlations in an environment. But we can decide to just have an infinite tape and introduce correlation somehow else.
I see. Yeah.
When you answered, you said this is the way you mean random fluctuations.
Random fluctuations and that happen to correlate with each other because the size of our tapes are finite.
But each bit is still 50.
Yes. Yes. And the sheer fact that it's a finite tape. So if you have 1,000 bits, the proportion of zeros and ones is going to be close to 50-50. So there is not going to be information in the one bit. The proportion of size two words is going to be more or less 1/4 for each, right? But the proportions of words of a larger size, they are not going to be evenly sampled. So there's going to be some useful information there in this finite environment. Sorry, you've been waiting for a while.
Just to clarify, for each bit guesser, do you sort of pre-specify the particular pattern it's trying to pick out?
I don't understand.
N equals 4 bit guesser. Are you loaded up with a pattern like 1001?
No. No. You generate the environment,
yep.
And for this environment, you generate the best guesser, meaning that all four guessers are the same. If we wanted, we could have made some evolutionary game in which different guessers with the same size fight each other.
Okay.
But we were not interested. We were interested in the limit case. So what happens when you get the most that you can given your environment? Right. And with these two things, I know the shortages of, of the model, as you're pointing out a little bit regarding the fluctuations and such. But I think that this model captures, in two very simple axes, the complexity of the environment, the complexity of the guessers, and furthermore, with this approach here, with this equation here that tells you, in average, how much reward you, each guesser is able to extract from each environment complexity. Through this parameter alpha that measures the harshness, meaning again how much reward you get for every bit that you get correctly, we think that this captures pretty much all the ingredients that we wanted to capture for that trade-off that I was talking about before. So we went on to do experiments. We pick up a one guesser, and we computed what is the likelihood that the one guesser in average in a lot of different environments of the same size is going to be able to guess one bit, right? So we draw this curve. And if you are in this gray area, meaning if your environment's of a certain size and your alpha, this means the amount of reward that you get for every bit that you guess correctly, is lower than this curve, then your guesser is going to survive, meaning that it's going to get a reward larger than zero. If you're above that, you're going to die. And when you do the same for different guessers, we find that this is a one guesser, two guesser, four guesser, or five, I don't remember, sorry, and 10 guesser. We find that each one of the curves spans a wider area. That means that more complex guessers are going to be able to survive in more in a larger number of environments. But we don't know yet if this, this also means, sorry, that if we take two guessers in the same setup, this means the same alpha and the same environment size. This also means that more complex guessers are going to be able to get more reward in average. But we don't know yet if this extra reward that they get is going to be sufficient to pay for their complex machinery to do inferences. Yes?
You're saying that complex systems do better in more environments, but very often they kind of highly optimized tolerance kind of away.
That is interesting. So we will need to think about the abundance of each one of these kinds of environments. I don't know how many such large environments we have. And on the other hand, we are looking at the maths here, right? And we hope that these maths translate into biology. I will need to think further about that. I don't have a clear answer to this insight. I don't have an intuition right now to think about that. I will need to think further. I think it will be nice to be able to think within this environment about what you are saying.
No.
So, given two guessers of different complexity in the same setup, this means the same alpha and the same environment size, a more complex environment is going to be able to accumulate more reward. But now a more complex guesser is going to be able to accumulate more reward. But now a more complex guesser is going to have, and I'm going to go into that right now, is going to have to pay a higher metabolic cost to be able to implement all the computations that it has to implement. So what we look at is now we put together those two pressures, the one towards replicating faster, as I was saying before, and the ones towards computing, which means you have to fulfill this extra metabolic cost. Each of them is optimal, meaning given its size, given its complexity, it got the best pattern that it can find in there.
I mean, to go back to David's point, it's less of a bit guesser, more of like a bit memorizer or something, right? I mean, the complex, the optimal one for a given environment is actually fit just to the particular random fluctuations mm-hmm. in that environment.
Yeah.
And if you put it in any different environment, the more complex it is, the less likely it is to...
Mm-hmm.
Again, match.
Yeah, so once again, if we wanted, we could have done evolutionary dynamics within an environment for guessers of a... Just imagine you get one environment fixed and you get a lot of three guessers and they fight each other.
I think it's beyond that. I'm just saying, if I understand correctly, the optimal guesser is like fit precisely to the patterns in a particular environment.
Yes.
So if you change the environment,
we change the guesser as well.
The more complex the guesser, the less likely that same pattern would appear.
But if we change the environment, we change the guesser as well.
But if you didn't.
If we did. Oh, no.
That's David's point.
Okay.
If you took the same, complex organism and took them from here to China, you would expect that the more complex one would be more fragile to that kind of dislocation.
I don't know.
You exactly haven't looked at that.
I don't know. I haven't looked at that. So... other experiments that we did, we took our guessers, we let them roam free, meaning if you're in an environment of a given size, if you're doing poorly, then you get to a simpler environment. If you're doing great, then you move to a higher environment, and environments, guessers of different complexity cluster around their preferred environment that has to do with the coups before. But this is not so interesting. The interesting thing happens when we do some ecological experiment in which we bring together guessers of different complexity. So in here you see an ecosystem with a series of spots. In each spot we put a guesser of a different complexity, and we pick up one of these guessers randomly to evaluate it in an environment, and here the size of the environment is fixed and also the alpha is fixed for simulations that follow. So whenever we pick up, we generate a new environment with the same size, and we evaluate with the same value of alpha. This means with the same cost to reward ratio. If our guesser performs correctly, it accrues reward. If it doesn't, if its reward after attempting to live in an environment is lower than zero, the guesser dies, and it's substituted by a zero guesser. This is an empty spot in the environment. If it accrues a lot of reward, this is... in the case that we wanted to try twice the size of the guesser, twice the complexity, then the guesser gets replicated and it's allocated to another random location of the environment, of the ecosystem. If there is another guesser in there, it steps on it, it's substituted, and the other guesser is erased from the simulation. So we run this for several values of alpha and complexity of the environment. This is sizes of the environment. And the picture that emerges, this is just for illustration. I am aware that the models don't compare, but the picture that emerges is this one here. What we find when we have simple enough environments, then it is relatively easy to guess bits from that environment correctly, or you get a lot of reward for every bit that you guess correctly. In that case, it doesn't pay off to have a very costly computational machine to help you infer what's going to happen next. So in that case, there is a pressure towards fast replication, as we saw, for example, in the Spiegelman monster experiment. And what we find is an abundance of one guessers while the other guessers go away. When your environment becomes more and more complicated, then for one guessers, it's not so easy to survive. And there is an actual evolutionary pressure towards the emergence of more complex machines, more complex guessers in this case. And I put this slide here just to compare not only with Wood's model up there, but also with recent surveys of empirical data. And once again, I know that they don't translate, but I think that this data is pointing towards some perhaps something more interesting than what Stephen Jay Gould was proposing, that random fluctuations were at the origins of complex life. Everything that I've talked about so far is in the first paper that I saw before. Once again, yes? It's a four guesser.
Oh, yeah. No, but the blue one's four, right?
Yes.
So what are the other terms in there? Is that like
two and three.
But so why do you think you got like so much better at mystically four, and the other guys just kind of like, I don't know, like two didn't seem to get you much, you know, and three didn't seem to get you much, but mystically when we get to four, all of a sudden you're like, oh, wow, that's great.
Well, this is, what you're looking at here is, I will fix an environment size and I will perform the experiment that I said before, all right? So I let this evolve for a very long time and we look at the steady distribution. This turns out to be it. There are cases in which you can explore for alpha, values of alpha and also environment sizes such that two guessers or three guessers, they become dominant. There will be more about that later. So as I was saying, any other questions so far? Every time that we pick up a guesser for evaluation, we generate a new environment of a given size. In some versions of the experiment, we generate, let's say, 10 environments, and we evaluate 10 times the guesser just to have an average. All right, so far, everything that I've shown you is in the first paper that I saw before. We think that we have this minimal two model that captures elements that are key in evolutionary theory and also in the information that you in the processing capacities that you need to extract information from your environment and be able to predict it, and we think that this offers at least numerical proof that the mere existence of more complex environment is an evolutionary pressure towards the emergence of more complex life, and we wanted more, so we say okay, enter parasites. There are several authors that have proposed that parasites can be also a pressure, they can make a contribution towards the emergence of complex structures in living systems or to just complexify phenotypes or genotypes. Examples that Nick Lane proposes is that parasites play a key role in the emergence of sex. And more recently, I don't know if you know this handbook of astrobiology that came out this year. It has some chapters that are okay and others that are just mind-blowing. I loved it. More precisely, this chapter, which is written by Frank Ryan and Luis Villarreal, it's about viruses in the origins of life. I loved it for many, many reasons. There is a lot of references in there. And there are some numbers that tell you, okay, look at this. This is how much, you're probably familiar with this, but this is how much viral DNA we have in our genome. So the mere fact that we have been in contact with viruses has introduced further complexity in our genome, if we think just about the kind of material that we find inside there. Then we have other cases like the evolution of photosynthesis, in which apparently, according to these authors and others, apparently viruses played a vital role. So some cyanobacteria will evolve photosynthesis, then apparently the genes for photosynthesis will be kept sequestered by viruses that will accelerate its evolution and then donate them back to a series of species. So apparently the coexistence of hosts and parasites opens a series of possibilities for the emergence of complex structures and for the complexification of life. We didn't want to go to any specific case of how, for example, this happened. Once again, we wanted to look at limit cases of what our guesser complexity, environment complexity, and now parasite complexity can tell us, and whether in some of those limit cases we could prove that the presence of a parasite will be an evolutionary pressure towards the selection of more complex guessers. And to do so, we implemented two versions of this just to be exhaustive. As I said before, we have an external environment that's a tape-like environment, zeros and ones. Then we have a guesser that elaborates the best guess that it can about the environment. This is another tape with zeros and ones. And this can become the environment of a parasite. And we call this, just for namesake, we call this a genotypic parasite. But then again, when we get our host bit guesser and we drop it in an environment, it starts trying to guess bits. And as it does so, it generates a behavior that is not necessarily the same as the string of ones and zeros that it has inside its black box. So also there might be parasites that prey on this behavior instead of preying on the internal pattern. And we call these phenotype parasites. This is just for names. We know that phenotypes and genotypes are much more complex than this. We just wanted to be exhaustive, so we tried the two versions of the model. And we performed a series of experiments. The first one only affects a phenotypic, of course, whenever a parasite predates on its host, it's going to take away some of the reward that the host had accumulated. And so you have a similar equation here for parasites, and we are going to have to extract from here whatever the parasite is taken away from the host, which is going to be this. This gamma is a parameter that controls how much the parasite takes away for every bit that it guesses correctly. This p over there is the likelihood that a parasite guesses correctly one bit given the host genotype or phenotype. So with this little correction, we proceed to do experiments. The first one that you can think about affects only phenotypic parasites because it's a behavioral experiment. But something that you can do is you get a fever. You say, okay, I'm gonna become a little bit more unpredictable by sometimes forgetting my best guess and becoming random. With this, I renounce the reward that I could have gotten, but I become more confusing for the parasite. Does this strategy pay off? Well, sometimes it does. What you see here is the black curve is the average, in each one of the plots, is the average reward that a host can gather for different values of the fever. So the more fever I have, the more randomly I behave. So usually I'm gonna fail. In some cases, such as this one here, giving myself a fever is enough to make your parasite go extinct. So there might be an optimal fever. There might be an optimal value that you of randomness that you give yourself in your behavior that makes yourself unpredictable enough to kill the parasite, and yet fit enough to get some reward from your environment.
So these are optimal guessers, mm-hmm. like before.
Yes.
But then on top of the optimal guessing that you calculate, you put randomness, and the parameter says how much randomness.
Yes, precisely. So every bit, you have a guess, which is the optimal one, and with a probability PF, you flip this bit. Yeah, and when the amount of reward that the parasite takes off of you is very little, it doesn't even pay off to have a fever. You just, the parasite either dies or is not relevant to you. But when this parameter becomes important, when the parasite is taking away a lot of your reward, then it becomes better to have a fever until it gets so much that it doesn't really matter. You're going to die anyway. After doing some behavioral experiments, we went back to our ecosystem. We wanted to do some ecological experiments. So we did the same experiment as before, and now we assume that everyone in our ecosystem is affected by a parasite, the simplest parasite, the parasite that just guesses one bit. This parasite never dies. We assume that it's to survive always, and everyone in the ecosystem is infected in this simulation. And what happens is that, and here you see for a changing value of alpha, you see the average complexity that you find in the ecosystem as you let it evolve for a very long time, and we assume it has a key of a steady state. So the black curve represents what happens when there is no parasite, and what happens is that when you get a lot of reward for every bit that you guess correctly, then once again it pays off to become to remain simple. It doesn't pay off to have a very complex computational machinery to try to guess what's going to happen, because you get almost food for free. As this parameter becomes harsher, this means as you get less and less reward for every bit that you guess correctly, then it becomes better to invest in a more complex computational machinery. So after simulating these ecosystems, it turns out that more complex guessers survive. And then in these simulations here, we limited our guessers to complexity between 1 and 10. We didn't put any more complex guessers. So there is going to be a harshness so high that no guesser in the ecosystem can deal with it, and everything goes extinct. When we introduce a parasite of either kind, genotype or phenotype parasites, when we introduce the simplest one actually in here, what happens automatically is that in average, the complexity, the average complexity of our ecosystems gets higher, but also the point of collapse of the ecosystem gets lower, which means that a harsher environment is more likely to kill all the hosts and all the parasites. And then finally, we went to eco-evolutionary experiments in which we had a similar setup as before with your ecosystems for hosts. And then we had a shadow ecosystem for parasites, this one here. We will proceed as before. We pick up a random bit guesser from the host ecosystem. We will evaluate it. We will get the reward that corresponds to its performance. And then we will pick the same parasite that occupies the same position in the shadow ecosystem. We will evaluate the parasite, and this parasite will, using this formula here, will drain away reward from the host towards the parasite. Once again, if the host performs very well after all this process, then it might replicate itself. If it performs badly, it dies. The same thing goes now for the parasite. It can replicate itself, it can die. And now, more importantly, we allow evolution. If the conditions are good, when you replicate yourself, your children might become just one bit more complex or one bit simpler for the next generation. And this goes both for hosts and parasites. And what happens first, if you put no parasite and you let this eco-evolutionary process go on, we select here a very easy environment. This is an environment in which for every bit that you guess correctly, you get a lot of reward. So unsurprisingly, what happens is that you start with an average complexity whatever, and over time, the more complex guessers die off because even being very simple, you are able to gather a lot of reward very quickly, and you're able to replicate yourself very quickly and colonize the whole ecosystem. Now, if we keep the same external environment, this is a very easy external environment that favors the presence of very simple bit guessers, and we introduce a parasite, and we make it so that it is relatively difficult for the parasite to replicate itself, yet it can survive. What happens is something similar to what we saw before. It's an enhanced average complexity of the host, and our parasite survives here. Red is going to be always parasites whenever I show these plots. All right. And now, if we lower the difficulty for the parasite to replicate, if we make it easier, if we make that parasites can replicate with less energy than in this scenario here, we arrive to this very interesting point, which is, we argue, a red queen dynamics, in which parasites and hosts become every time more complex, trying to escape from each other. What we think is happening, what we are pretty sure is happening, is this one here. Say you have a range of parasites in there, and also a range of hosts. If you are very simple, your parasites are going to be able to predict very well what you're going to do. They're going to be able to extract a lot of your reward, and you might die. So the presence of a parasite effectively represses simple hosts. This is, by the way, data from real simulations. I didn't make up these curves. On the other hand, if you are more complex, you have it easier to escape those parasites. So there's going to be an advantage for you to become more complex. So this part of the population is going to be enhanced somehow. On the other hand, if you are a complex host, very, very simple parasites are going to have it more complicated to keep track of you, and they are going to die off. But more complex parasites are going to have an advantage over the other, and they are going to be selected for in their shadow ecosystem. So we think that this game here produces a blank slide. Well, it's what you will see. It's another distribution like this farther in time. This is from a real simulation, and there will be two arrows pointing forward. So this results in two forces that tend to move hosts and parasites towards ever more complexity, and still doesn't show up. And what you see here, it's a pity, because this is in this plot here, I can show you later, it's a larger simulation over more and more and more iterations, and you can see how the complexity of both hosts and parasites keeps increasing. I will show you more later. Both of them keep increasing, and you could think several things. For example, you might think that maybe the gap of complexity between hosts and parasites, it might remain constant. Maybe if the parasite goes a lot ahead, maybe it runs free from the parasites and they go extinct. I don't know. Well, what we see in our simulations is this here. The complexity gap between hosts and parasites seems to grow linearly. This is time, but when we plot it when we plot the complexity of the parasites versus the one of the hosts, we see that it grows roughly linearly. We think this is very interesting, because even though the model is very, very, very abstract, and we were just trying to abstract away the key components of how these dynamics might work, this is an empirical prediction. This tells you, okay, it seems that as the complexity of both hosts and parasites, according to this model, the gap between them should grow. Is this true? Can we check for that? Do any of you know if this is true? I will be very interested in that. Many more things. You might think that maybe the average complexity of hosts and parasites becomes more complex because somehow when they are bigger, they are exhausting the resources of the environment, and they are effectively, the environment is effectively becoming less populated. When we look at the simulations, we find that the occupancy of the host ecosystem remains very, very high, close to 100% all the time. The occupancy of the parasite ecosystem is large throughout. This is 90%, and it seems there is a lot of noise, and it seems to grow as the complexity of both hosts and parasites grows as well. And also, if we look at this, we see that the variance of the complexity within both populations seems to increase as time passes by and as the complexity of both hosts and parasites increase. Here you see several simulations. In time, this is relatively large amount of time, and the only thing that changes here is the difficulty for parasites to replicate. So in the upper left corner, it's very, very difficult, relatively difficult for a parasite to replicate. This means it has to gather a lot of reward because it can't replicate itself. So what happens is that the parasite dies off, and the hosts tend to their minimal complexity. As we increase the as we decrease this amount of energy, so to say, this amount of reward that parasites need to replicate themselves, first we see a sustained coexistence, as I saw before. Then this thing that we think is Red Queen dynamics starts to happen, and we see it taking place. And then, more importantly, when parasites have it very, very, very easy to replicate, we come to this regime in which we see punctuated equilibrium and a kind of sudden gaps, sudden jumps in the complexity of our model. This was not wired into the model. This came up as a surprise. We were not expecting for that. There are many things that we want to see in the model. When the plots started to come out, we were very excited. Everything that I showed you so far have been for phenotypic parasites.
We usually let people go around one, I think, that need to leave.
I'm almost finished.
Okay.
Just to tell you, up to here, everything that I was showing to you was phenotypic parasites. All the way up to here, they were very similar. When we go to genotypic parasites, we find more diversity of stuff, such as ecosystems that collapse and ecosystems that remain in a steady state of sustained host and parasite complexity for a long time, and they start off again in this race of complexity. And this is the end of the talk, finally. I think, once again, that we have the simplest, not arguably the simplest, or very close to the simplest toy model in which we can bring together evolution through natural selection, information theory, and a problem in which you try to predict what your environment is going to be do next. We think that our model comes close to what is the best that you can do, given this complexity and in the environment and the one that you have within. And we think that with the introduction of parasites, we find yet stronger, and in this case, given this red queen dynamics nature of what we find, we think that they are very, very strong evolutionary pressures towards the emergence of complex life. So now that picture from Stephen Jay Gould, in which complex life might have a reason because of random fluctuation, I think that it becomes the question it turns on its head. Is now it's like, how can you not become so much complex when parasites alone, in the very simplest model, could make such a strong pressure? And this is it. This paper should come out very soon. Ricard is working on it, and I'm here. happy to tell you more details about how the things work, what I'm doing with this now, and so on and so forth. And thank you very much for listening.
Microbial parasites lose genome complexity, and such an extreme extent that basically the most advanced parasites, all they have left are their reproductive organs and some way of invading the host.
Mm-hmm.
And that arms race of the red queen dynamics is of course very real, but it often does not require any increase in complexity in anything. You think about influenza, for example, or any kind of viruses, right? That infect higher organisms. What you often have is that they have antigens that mutate constantly and thereby evade the immune system, which tries to adapt by mutating as well. But there's no net increase in complexity.
Mm-hmm.
So I think when you guys write that paper, it may be useful to actually juxtapose what you find with that older debate.
Yeah, we do. And we acknowledge that there are many things that we cannot put in the model. For example, there's all these cases in which both parasites and their hosts co-evolve so that the dynamics don't remain so aggressive. And this is something that we don't have in our model. So what we try to do is, hey, look at this. Our maths tell us this is a limit case. And now there is reality. And reality has all kind of messy stuff. And reality has other dimensions that you might not need to explore, that we don't explore in this model. So what we wanted to do once again was to find those limit cases in a model in which we force that every interaction is made through information theoretical elements and in which we can quantify this complexity in a very definite way. But I agree perfectly with you. The debate is far from over. But once again, I think that the nice races that we see, I think that they pose the opposite question, which is, okay, what dynamics will counteract that so that we say the kind of phenomenology that you're talking about? Either one?
Just a question about the model. If a host dies, does the corresponding parasite automatically die, or does it stick around in its slot?
In this version, if I remember correctly, it dies. I have implemented versions in which it becomes the host. And then there is another thing. Because of the limitations of the model, parasites, guessers always have to be simpler than their environment. So parasites have to be simpler than their hosts. So whenever a parasite invades a position that is occupied by a more complex host, it is promoted to host. And this is important because it limits, in some cases that I didn't show here because they are not relevant, the model just crashes. And it's. But this thing that I just said of a parasite being promoted to host, it almost never happens. I just did it because I didn't want to have parasites that were simpler. And then when I run the simulations, it turned out not to happen often. Yes?
So it's quite clear how this model could have explanatory power with respect to the emergence of cognitively complex life.
We think so.
Yeah. What's less clear to me is whether it has explanatory power with respect to the emergence of morphologically or physiologically complex life, right? So there's a sense in which a multicellular organism, let alone being mammal like us, is much more complex physiologically than a single cell bacterium, regardless of you know, what's going on in the brain and what moods are in. Do you think there's any relevance here, or do you think that's just two separate problems?
I think that there is relevance, and I think that it might have explanatory power in that sense. I also think that we might have uncovered one evolutionary pressure, one important evolutionary pressure, not the only one.
Okay.
There is a nice case. I'm going to comment it anyway because we're friends. When I was writing the paper, there was this case that I thought about. So there are some people that treat the male as a parasite of a female, right? Which makes a lot of sense. If this were true, and you have it becomes more complicated, of course, because now the fitness of one and the other, they are going to be tightly linked. But if our limit case is true, this will mean that similar evolutionary pressures will also be there. And then you have all these kind of morphological evolutions of the genitalia in insects, for example, which are a lot of fun, right? And these are loose ends. But I like to think along those lines. And I say this because we're friends. I will not say this in an official conference of a very important institution,
okay.
Other than this.
Could be the next paper, a model of genitalia evolution.
Perhaps, if someone has data, I want to work on that. But all right. No more questions. So thank you very much for listening and for your questions.
I think that horizontal gene transfer is a very interesting problem. I wanted to think how to fit it here and what question might be answerable from this.
So you could figure out how much horizontal gene transfer leads to the emergence of more and more complex systems. Like,
mm-hmm.
when does it get to be a problem, right? When we're like, oh, we get way too much horizontal gene transfer, and it's like, oh, that
mm-hmm.
turned out to be a really bad
yeah.
thing rather than a good thing.
Yeah. I don't. You probably are familiar with the work of Nigel Cole.
Yeah.
I discovered last year when I was working on that, and I love it when there is all this kind of a lock that you put on horizontal gene transfer. I have to get it right. I read it once, twice, those papers, but it fascinates me.
Yeah.
I still have to.